Pennsylvanians with intellectual and developmental disabilities on the waiver that are at risk for losing their services because of a lack of direct support professionals able to care for them. So I am honored to be joined by a august panel of experts that can talk about this, and that includes people who are actually on the waiver, a person who's on the waiver, and a person who is a direct support provider. So I'd like to start with just a very brief introduction. We're going to start with G.N. Janes, who is the CEO of Valley Community Services, who's going to provide an overview of the issue.
Before we get started, a couple of people have joined us, Representative Serrato and Secretary Tina Davis online. Thank you.
Thank you, colleagues, for joining us. So I want to introduce our panel. We're going to start with G.N. Janes, who is the CEO of Valley Community Services, who's going to provide an overview of the issue. Michael Anderson, who is a legislative advocate from the ARC of Philadelphia. Corinne Butts, who is a direct support professional for Michael. And also Dr. Josie Badger, who is joining us on Teams, who is the founder of Badger Consulting Incorporated. So let's start with G.N. Janes. G.N., thank you.
Thank you, Representative Kahn. Good afternoon. My name is G.N. Janes. I am the Chief Executive Officer of Valley Community Services, a not-for-profit organization with a mission to support persons with intellectual disabilities and autism. We currently support 160 Pennsylvanians in various capacities across 9 counties throughout the Commonwealth. We do this with the help of 317 direct support professionals who work in a myriad of ways to ensure that people with intellectual disabilities and autism live everyday lives in their communities. Like almost every other similar organization, we have relied almost exclusively on our state and federal partners' distribution of Medicaid dollars to complete our mission. We have historically struggled to maintain a full complement of employees. I often say we were short-staffed before it was cool. There have always been cracks in our staffing foundation. We patched them together as best we could with the Herculean efforts of a devoted group of frontline workers and a philosophy of completing the mission. Unfortunately, this post-pandemic era feels different. Direct support professionals are being ground down and stuck working grueling hours to keep those we support safe. For every 100 hours of Valley Community Services DSP is working, fully 20 are overtime. We've been forced to close residential homes and a day program. Our once vibrant in-home and community supports program has gone from over 140 participants to just 27. We are not alone. According to a recent survey, the statewide turnover rate for DSPs is 37%, and the vacancy rate is 24%, down from a peak of 40%. That's not cause for celebration. Rather, it's caused by the contraction of supports that established providers are able to offer. The job has never been easy. I am amazed that direct support professionals have stuck with us through the low pay, high turnover, and demanding work hours. But for their altruism, our brittle system would be completely fissured. We owe them a living wage because they have dedicated their lives to something greater than themselves. I thank you for listening to us and hope you might empower us to give it to them. Thank you.
Thank you, GN. I wanted to acknowledge my colleague, Representative Abigail Salisbury, who just joined us. Thank you, Abby. Also want to just acknowledge Mark Davis, who's the president and CEO of PAR, who's joining us as well. Thank you. So next on our list is Michael Anderson, who's the legislative advocate from the ARC of Philadelphia. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Michael Anderson. Thank you for allowing me to speak today on an extremely important issue, increasing the wages for DSPs, direct support professionals. I know the importance of this issue for personal experience. I'm a 41-year-old man from Merritt State. It's a radio right outside of Philadelphia. Where Sample Party. I own my own home. Two other men, both of whom also have physical disabilities. This is not a group home. Because of my disability, I need 24-hour attendant care 7 days a week to handle the activities of daily living, such as getting out of bed, going to the bathroom, getting a shower, getting dressed, etc., eating my meals, my laundry, cleaning my room, and going out in the community where I work, volunteer, go to concerts and sporting events, and visit family. Without the support, I would have to go into a nursing home where the level of care is, the level of freedom is much more limited. Nursing homes are only required to provide 2.7 hours of direct care per day, and they don't provide the support I need to live and to leave the institute and participate in the community. There are many places that there are places that people go to die, and I do not want to be one of them. For the last several years, even before COVID, I have a lot of trouble hiring and keeping attendants. The main reason of the wages, the reason is that the wages of DSPs haven't kept up with wages in the community. People working at Target and McDonald's make much more. Most of my attendants make only $12 an hour without benefits. This is increased me. They don't have, I have to rely on my father to fill in the gap. He is 68 years old, and I think that's way too old. And lots of people don't even have family members who can be backups. The idea of family safety net behind home and community-based services is nonsense. There are two different programs that provide attendant care for people with disabilities. As a person with a physical disability, I have been enrolled in the Community Health Choice Wave program through the Office for Long-Term Living. People with intellectual disability or autism are usually enrolled in ID program from the Office of Developmental Programs. Both services are crisis. I call on the Pennsylvania Legislature to direct our providers and all managed care organizations to give DSPs a livable wage, at least $20 an hour, to make sure that both systems are equally funded and allow this to happen. People with disabilities should receive the services that they both need and deserve. I don't want to choose between a nursing home and my aged parents. I would rather live independently and let my parents live that way too. And thank you for inviting me to speak.
Thank you, Michael.
Yes, we thank you very much, Michael, for those remarks. And we have a lot of questions for you as well. I would like to mention that we've been joined by my colleague, Representative Friel-Lawton, Representative Cephas, Representative Kazim. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Schusterman. I'd like to announce our next speaker, Kyrene Butts, who's the direct support professional. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Kyrene Butts, and I'm here to share my story on the crisis with the incredible DSP workers in our state. I have been working with Michael as a DSP worker for 3 years, and I have witnessed firsthand the tremendous impact that we have, that we as DSP workers have on people's lives. I have been a source of hope, guidance, and support for Michael and his family. I have assisted Michael with daily living skills, provided him with companionship, friendship, and given him a sense of purpose and belonging. However, I've also seen the many challenges that we as DSP workers face, including long work hours, low wages, and limited benefits, or no benefits at all. Despite our dedication and hard work, many of us DSP workers are struggling to make ends meet, and we even sometimes have to work multiple jobs to support ourselves and our families. This is unacceptable and unfair. DSP workers are essential workers, especially during the pandemic. We put our health and safety on the line every day to care for some of the most vulnerable people in our society. We deserve to be valued, respected, and compensated for our vital work. That is why I urge the Pennsylvania lawmakers to increase the wages of DSP workers to a livable wage that reflects the true value of our hard work. This will not only benefit DSP workers, but also improve the quality of care services, the care and services for people with disabilities. It will also reduce turnover, increase job satisfaction, and boost the economy. I speak from personal experience when I say that DSP workers are more than just employees. We are extended family, friends, mentors, and heroes to the individuals we care for and their families. We make significant differences in those we care for lives, and we deserve to have a fair and decent wage for our invaluable work. Thank you for your attention, and I hope that you could take the action to support DSP workers and their clients.
Thank you, Kyrene. Our last speaker on the panel is Dr. Josie Badger, who's the founder of Badger Consulting. And Dr. Badger is joining us via Teams. Thank you.
Yes. I wish I could be there today, but because of inability to get personal care attendance or DSPs, I am on my couch. So good afternoon, everyone. If you don't know me, I'm Dr. Josie Badger, the doctor of silence. I am an entrepreneur, a business owner, a homeowner, a voter, a wife, and now a mom. But I am not here to talk about my accolades. I'm here to talk about what allows me to do those things. As an individual with a significant physical disability, my independence and success rely on the availability of high quality, dependable, and compassionate personal care attendants. I have a genetic condition that, in short, causes all of my voluntary muscles to be weakened with use. Therefore, I use a ventilator, a power wheelchair, and 24-hour care to be able to live independently and have a job. I rely on the care made available through medical assistance and waivers, specifically through MOD. And with only a physical disability that does not include an intellectual disability diagnosis, I was limited in what waivers I could apply for. I was put on OBRA and now have been moved to Community Health Choices. Being on the waivers available for people with just physical disabilities through the Office of Long-Term Living means a more limited scope of available supports and significantly lower pay for direct service providers in spite of the level of care needed and the support provided by my aides. Since the pandemic, the care crisis has grown exponentially. Individuals who worked in the field because they loved it can no longer afford to work. There is no wonder why people with disabilities are often taken advantage of by their own care providers. As an individual who knows the high turnover rates in caregiving and the devastating impacts that can occur when a caregiver leaves, a lot gets swept under a rug to be able to maintain our support. Neglect, theft and abuse may be kept a secret so the individuals know that the care to get out of bed the next day will still be there. Our safety and security should not be placed in the hands of individuals who cannot keep a better paying job. And our diagnosis should not dictate whether we are able to pay a fair, livable wage to our care providers. Changes need to be made so that all caregivers make at least a livable wage with cost of living adjustments built in. If our state wants to pride itself in supporting Pennsylvanians, then it is time to invest in the largest minority group in the state, people with disabilities and their caregivers. Thank you.
But I just wanted to add on Josie Badger's point that I've had to deal with a lot of theft and a lot of neglect myself, and I'm sick of it. I had to get rid of a lot of my, quote, friends because I thought they really cared about me. They still do, but I've had to go to tons of people due to neglect and theft of money and all sorts of other things.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Dr. Badger. So I want to lead off the questions to the panel with a direct question about what we can actually do about this crisis. Earlier today, I was at the appropriations meeting, and I sat in, and they talked about the waiting list, you know, decreasing the wait for people to get services. Is that the answer to this, the DSP crisis, to addressing the DSP crisis? If not, what is the answer to help address the DSP crisis for the home and community-based waiver?
Thank you, Representative Kahn. I don't think any provider of IDA supports is against eliminating the waiting list, but we need to have qualified direct support professionals to fill those roles. And unfortunately, the reimbursement rate as it is, it's very, very difficult to do that. We had a statewide survey from six provider associations supporting over 30,000 people with intellectual disabilities and autism. Right now, one out of every four jobs are vacant. It's impossible to address that waiting list when you have those vacancies. And we're unable to provide a living wage for these folks. And I'll tell you right out of the gate, the Office of Developmental Programs has a reimbursement system that is based on acuity rates of people with intellectual disabilities. They came up with a formulary, and the formulary has a wage assumption of $15 an hour for those folks. And I don't think it's, I do think it's ironic that for the last two administrations, we've wanted to make the minimum wage $15 an hour. And I can tell you without hesitation, this is not a minimum wage job. These folks are sacrificing their entire lives. This is a career for them. I have people that have worked in my organization for over 30 years. Have dedicated their lives to providing these supports. And when I go through town halls across the state from to talk to my employees, a lot of the people my age, I'm 50 years old, tell me, I can't do this anymore. I can't physically do this. I've got to find a better paying job because I'm getting ready to retire. So it is it's a difficult situation that we're in right now, and it in the end, we really need to raise that reimbursement rate for those folks.
On that point, so you're saying would that be through the budget allocation for the home and community based service? Can you clarify?
Yes, those are home and community based services rates, not intermediate care facility rates.
And my dad would like to speak for me on this part.
Well, first of all, I would like to take umbrage at being too old. I am Mark Anderson, Michael's dad. I would say that, as Michael mentioned in his comments, there are two systems, which is kind of strange, one for people primarily with a physical disability diagnosis and one for people with an intellectual disability, autism. There is no waiting list on the physical disability side to get services once you reach the age of 18. The problem there is not paying enough money, and they're paying even less money typically to people who are on the physical disability side than they are to people on the ID autism side.
Which does not make sense for me, which I call BS, to be honest with you.
Right, right. But also, I mean, you know, if you eliminate the waiting list somehow and make enough money available to hire enough people, if you're not paying them enough, once again, it's not going to solve that crisis. So they need more money to reduce the waiting list, but they also need more money to increase the wages for the direct care workers.
I just add one more point. I had to lose one of my favorite attendants this past fall because he had to take care of 5 kids, and this salary wouldn't fly with you. I mean, I've had so much turnover, it's not funny.
I would just say his father hasn't turned over yet.
Karen, could you add your comments to this question?
I'll have anything to say. Sorry.
Okay, so before we go, Dr. Badger?
Yeah, thank you. I didn't know if you could see this or not. So my comment is, yes, we can't have direct care providers being paid what minimum wage is. Okay, that's just straight up. And so I'm not opposed to increasing the minimum wage, but this isn't a minimum wage job, just as was mentioned. But there are some things that can be changed, one of which is that at the federal level, Medicaid allows for individuals to self-hire, but then use a fiscal mediator like Tempus, which we already use, to hire and coordinate all personal care attendants. Now, this is only personal care attendants, and an individual has to be able to do sort of the hiring process and everything, but it allows an individual to pay significantly more for an individual. But that's only one piece of this, and this would be to amend some of our CMS plans within the state to allow this to happen more.
Thank you. We're going to go to questions. Rep. Freelotten.
Thank you. This issue is one of the main issues that we face in our office every day, dealing with families who are experiencing the difficulties of finding care workers, losing care workers, all of the cascading impacts that then happen to families as a result of that. And this is also a very personal issue in my life. My nephew Ian was born with severe developmental disabilities, and he has a tetralogy flow with an absent pulmonary valve, so his heart has a defect, which then caused a lung defect. He has one working lung, one working kidney, and one arm. He is a miracle in that because of the direct care workforce and the support that my family has been able to provide for him, he plays Miracle League baseball. He's 9 now. I sat in the room with my brother-in-law when the cardiologist came in on the day he was born and said that he would not live. He is 9 years old, doing extremely well. His nurses and direct care workers are family to us. My son Jack was born 3 months after Ian, and Peter and Megan, who are his full-time nurses, they consider them to be their aunt and uncle. Like, they don't know any different. They are family. And we've recently lost Peter because he got married and he wants to start a family. And the job does not provide health care to support that. And then we recently lost Megan because Megan just started a family and had a baby, and their health care does not support that for them. And the cascading impacts that has then had on my my sister and her husband and their family are tremendous. Both my brother-in-law and my sister work full-time in very high-paying executive-level jobs. And so regardless of your income, even if you can afford the care, it's not always available to you. They have to shift at night. So my sister will sleep from 9 p.m. to 1 a.m. To be able to get up at 1 a.m. and provide her husband with sleep. He sleeps from 9 to 1. She stays up from 9 to 1. And then the other one will get up from 1 to 6 and be up with Ian at nighttime. And this is multiple nights a week, because they can't get care workers to cover their shifts, even though they could private pay for it if they wanted to. They also have the services and the waivers. My question is related to, this is not a minimum wage job. It by far is not a minimum wage job. And we definitely need living wages, but we also need benefits. And one of the provisions that Philadelphia has done is under Fair Work Week is allowing direct service professionals and home care nurses to have the ability to plan their lives. Oftentimes, if your client goes into a hospitalization, you suddenly don't have shifts for that week, and you're an hourly worker, so you're not getting paid a salary. These are all things that contribute to these jobs not being sustainable for people beyond, the earlier years of when you're starting out. In addition to that, they don't provide health care and often or retirement benefits, which somebody, when you are progressing in your life, need all of those things. And then the cascading impacts to the families, who then have to adjust everything in their lives. And I can't tell you how many constituents I have who can no longer work, who have had physical injuries as a result of caring for somebody that they are not physically able to care for in the way that is necessary. And then also the stress and mental health impacts of parents who are constantly dealing with these stresses. And so I wonder if you can give any insight into that. I live it with my family, so I see it firsthand, but I don't know that people who sit in our roles really truly understand the cascading impacts of the problems with not just the wages, but everything else when it comes to having a sustaining job.
I agree with you. I just don't know how we can provide benefits and health care. If we could do that right now, I would do it. Can you speak to it, Gian, at all?
Sure, happy to do that, Michael. Thank you. First, Representative Freelotin, I appreciate your comments. You clearly get it. I don't, that's very refreshing. So I appreciate that. I can tell you that in my organization, there is definitely an inordinate amount of direct support professionals, or there are, that happen to be single mothers. And I think if you looked at the data across the state, you're going to see a larger than average percentage. And it's very difficult with the short staffing that we have. A lot of these DSPs have to make the decision when their relief doesn't show up. Do I abandon my shift and put the person that I'm supporting at risk, or come back and say to my healthcare or my child care provider, hey, I can't pick this person up, and it could be a family member. Oftentimes, it's not child care because our folks can't afford child care. How do you make that decision? It is extremely difficult. On the subject of benefits, I'll tell you this. Because of the stagnant reimbursement rates, what I have been forced to do, and I do offer health insurance, I offer retirement, but I have had to pare those down in order to raise the rate to the current rate that I'm providing right now. I'll tell you, our starting wage is $16 an hour. And when I post that on social media, I get a lot of laugh emojis from people commenting on it, because they say, how can you call someone a professional and you're paying them $16 an hour? And if you look at the list of all the things that DSPs are doing, they're providing medication administration, they're providing physical therapy assistance, they're providing transportation. There's so many things that incorporate what a DSP is. I absolutely have no qualms calling them a direct support professional because that's what they are.
And to be honest with you, I don't know what I would do if I had a game. And, like, for instance, I'm just giving you an example. If I have to go to work and, next month, my parents are going to France, so without the DSPs, I would probably be at home watching TV and not out in the community at all. Luckily, I have a backup, but I'm just saying for people that don't have backup, I don't know what would happen when their parents have to go abroad.
Just a few things. I mean, Michael is fortunate, and our family is pretty fortunate in terms of our economic situation. And I'm not a DSP because of the wages, but one of the reasons I retired from teaching,
there were so many call-outs.
I'm a law professor, I was. And so I kind of had during COVID and before, I had two jobs. And so by retiring, I basically cut down to one. So it was something that I could manage in a more reasonable way. And now we are in a sort of, you never know how long this is going to last. We're in a situation now where Michael actually has coverage for all of the shifts that he has during the week. And I mean, Kyron can only work so much, but we have good people that we like. And so for now it's working, but you never know for how long. And, there are a lot of things that, my wife is just retiring too, so it's like this is our big trip to France. So we have like three different layers of protection set up in case this doesn't happen, and that doesn't happen. But there have been a lot of times where the two of us have planned to go places, and it's like.
They had to call out.
So it's like, all right, you go, I'll stay, and then I go, and you stay, and so things like that. So it certainly has a lot of follow-on effects to the lives of people. And as Michael has said and others have said, a lot of people are not in as good a situation.
No.
And either their parents are just too old, they can't do it anymore.
Or they're dead. Or
their parents aren't around or not involved. And, parents are willing to do just about anything for their children because they're your kids. But not everybody has those parents to step in. And it's just not a good way to run a railroad. I like the time that I spend with Michael to be the time that we're having a good time, and I'm just
we're hanging out.
That's right.
Talking sports, whatever.
Don't give away our secrets. anyway, but yeah. So there are a lot of effects.
I call him every day for a sports update or a news update.
Now you're really giving away our secrets. Sorry.
Before we get to Dr. Badger, Karen, do you have a comment?
I was going to just give an example of like how, like last week, for example, my mom had to get surgery and I couldn't make it into work and I had to call out. And if it wasn't for Michael's dad being there, he would just be there by himself, And a lot of people fall into these situations and it's unfortunate, but we definitely need to do something about it.
I would just say, an ideal situation, there would be backup, but the backup... doesn't exist.
They say call us if you need backup. So I call them and they're like, we'll work on somebody. How the hell is that supposed to work?
Well, and there just aren't enough people around to fill in. So.
Dr. Badger.
Thank you. And I just wanted to raise up a couple other situations that occur, for me. And I have a good number of friends as the person with the physical disability, we end up being actually the breadwinner for our families because our partners, our spouses are not able to maintain a job because of the lack of caregivers. And so I've had my business, and especially during the pandemic and now, there's not enough caregivers. So my husband hasn't been able to work. He just started working again, but I'm home alone. And so if I need something, I'm in deep trouble. So we have a lot of individuals, no one being able to work. So they end up being on the confines of poverty and social security, or the actual person with disability is the breadwinner. And those are not great situations either direction. We also need to be looking at things like paid family and medical leave, Family Care Act, where individuals who don't have paid time off, such as those caregivers, can take that time to be with their family. Because I know a lot of my friends and family who would be direct care providers aren't, because they don't have time to take off if they get sick or if they have a child who's ill. And so we need to start looking at larger state levels, because just as Jeanne was talking about, there's not enough reimbursement going in to the individual companies to be able to provide those supports that like Walmart can provide.
Thank you. And before moving on to the next question, I do want to make a comment on Rep. Friel-Otten's personal experience. It looks like we are creating a system that's an obstacle course on both sides. And with a system that difficult, people are not going to be able to stay in that system. They're going to leave the state. They're going to go work in a different arena. And where does that leave this population? This population that would like to go to work, would like to go and watch a soccer game. So we have some heavy lifting this year with the budget, just to get things normalized, just to get things back on track. And then we have to increase wages. There's so much more, possibly find a way that transportation, reduce costs for transportation for our DSPs, or a way to really incorporate them into our communities, because rent is going sky high. So this is a far-reaching issue, but I'm going to continue with the people who have questions. Rep. Fleming.
Thank you, Madam Vice Chair. So I just want to ask pointedly, when was the last rate increase in this sector? And it went from what rate, what reimbursed rate to what?
It's been about, to my recollection, at least 10, 15 years. And that's gone way too long. 10 or 15 years is way too long.
But just to sort of clarify, I'm not sure what the reimbursement rates are, but in terms of what the actual pay to the direct care workers that Michael has, that really hasn't changed for 10 to 15 years.
Okay, so it's pretty much stayed flat, stagnant. Okay.
So that's one of the problems, you know, as wages in the community have risen, wages for direct care workers haven't really gone up, at least.
I don't mean to dominate the hearing, but when my house first started, there was nobody leaving for 5 years because the wages were up to what the economy is. Now with inflation, people leave all the time. I went as my longest caregiver, and I couldn't say that at the beginning.
Okay, thank you for clarifying, Michael. And the reason why I ask is because, you know, even when we as legislators take steps to solve an issue like increasing rates and, you know, putting that into the budget, we heard from Secretary Arkush this morning at the Department of Human Services hearing that that may not necessarily trickle down to the workforce, which is incredibly disturbing to me. So I just want to make sure that even when we do the right thing, when this General Assembly does the right thing and invests the dollars that it's supposed to, you know, my question was in the context of home health care, but the answer sort of made it seem like that happens in a variety of sectors where, and so can you speak to that, GN, as a business owner and making sure that those wages from those increases actually get to your professionals?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Representative. First, I believe I did get to hear a little bit of Secretary Arkush's statements on the appropriations hearing, and I believe she was referring to long-term living with managed care organizations. Luckily, I should say that the people that I have working for me are not under that reimbursement rate.
Okay.
We're separate. We don't have a managed care organization in between ourselves and the payer. Our last rate refresh was January 1 of 2022, and when you look at the statistics, the average wage went up considerably in our field.
Okay.
Even if we were, if we wanted to withhold those reimbursement rates, which we absolutely do not, we couldn't, just because we're so far behind in wages, there'd be no way for us to address it. It certainly has not caught up to the inflation rate.
Sure.
Since the January 1, 2022 rate refresh, and it didn't capture, in my estimation, the cost from the last rate refresh, which was 3 years prior to that. It's very difficult for us because of I have two large cost drivers in the organization. Number one is wages, mm-hmm. and number two is benefits. Mm-hmm. And the benefits portion of my costs have skyrocketed. And we're doing things as best we can as nonprofits.
Right.
I think you'd be amazed at how many nonprofit organizations can tell you what a prescription benefits manager is.
Sure.
Right. A captive healthcare network, mm-hmm. but we're sort of forced to be innovative to sort of reduce those cost drivers because they're not catching those reimbursement rates aren't reflecting that.
Right. Well, thank you for clarifying my point that it was more on the MCO side. So I really do appreciate that. And I just want to leave everyone with sort of my standard reminder that we have money in our budget stabilization fund, the rainy day fund, to help solve these issues. I just saw recently from the March collections, we are $1.1 billion over estimate in our revenue collections. We have the resources to do this. The time is now, so thank you so much.
Representative Fleming, let me just say I have an umbrella in Michael's backpack.
Thank you. And before we continue with questions, I want to welcome online Rep. Briggs and right here in person, Representative Smith Waddell. I think Rep. Kahn has a question follow up.
Yeah, just on that point. So I believe, I may have this wrong, but I believe that the budget for the home and community based waiver was recommended at $384 million. Increase, is that the amount that is being looked for from the community?
Thank you, Representative Kahn. Those funds are for two things, as far as I know. One is to address the waiting list, and two is to backfill the ARPA funds. The reimbursement rate, I believe, for every dollar spent during the public health emergency, 58 cents was federal, 42 cents was state. That rate's going to go down, I believe, 42, 48. So those dollars were set aside to address those issues. Certainly not something, there's also, I think, some money set aside for community participation supports to maintain that rate, reimbursement rate, as it is. There's nothing there to address increasing direct support professional wages. And that would be the primary driver that we'd be looking for, is to get those reimbursement rates up so we can get those DSP wages up.
I just wanted to say, I think the ask in the letter was a $430 million increase, correct?
So yeah, we were asking for an additional $430 million in order to raise those DSP wages.
Okay, and I think the offer was like $380, so it's short of what the administration is offering. It's about $50 million short.
I think we would be asking for the $430 million was directly to fund those DSP wages. So this would be in addition to the dollars that the state is going to have to kick in because of the public health emergency ending.
Okay, now to the surefire question in the last 10 minutes. These are going to be quick. We have quite a few people who have questions. Rep. Cephas first.
I will be quick. So first and foremost, I want to thank Rep. Kahn and you, Vice Chair, for
organizing this conversation, and shout out to Mr. Butts, who is directly from my district. We got to get a picture before you go. And thank you to the panelists for, you know, yet again raising the alarm on a system that we know has been broken for some time. And, you know, I think, you know, not just fighting the fight pre-COVID, I feel like the pandemic shined a light even more on what we need to be doing in this moment and as we move forward to really shore up this system. My question is directed at as to what are other states doing? I know we're talking about fighting for a minimum wage, but I can honestly say, coming from Philadelphia County, the minimum wage that, you know, we were fighting for this year, the minimum wage that we fought for last year, won't cut it in the county of Philadelphia, where at the very least, you know, thankful to my colleague, Representative Green, for offering a minimum wage of $18, would only get a single individual making $31,000 a year. So we still have a long way to go as it relates to ensuring that wages actually match the type of work that you all are doing and is actually able to attract people into, you know, that line of work. One of the things that Governor Shapiro did was target certain industries and target certain workforces to provide incentives to encourage more individuals through that pipeline. So if you think about police officers, nurses, and teachers, any thought on what other incentives are being offered in other states to, you know, get more people into the workforce? And, you know, what are the wages looking like in other states so we can ensure as Pennsylvania we remain competitive in this space, not just for workers but also for families? Thank you, Chair.
One of my wishes will be PTO. These workers work way too hard for no PTO.
Personal time off?
Yeah.
Okay. But
paid time off.
I'm just going to say, and I want to make this very clear, I have no idea.
In Boston, my friend can pay them $15 an hour, but I have no idea either.
May I add? Let me know if you can't hear me. My headset died. So those are, like, benefits are great, but when opening salary is $12 an hour and they clear $8 an hour, that, like, there's no benefit that can necessarily change not being able to pay for gas to get to the job in the first place. And so wages have to be a part of it. I agree, like, paid time off, even for sick days or caring for loved ones. But, I mean, if the salary isn't there, it doesn't matter.
Thank you. We're moving on to Representative Borofsky has a question.
Great. Thank you very much, Madam Vice Chair.
Wait, I'm sorry. We have the Chair of Labor, Representative Dawkins, and I just want to thank him for joining us. Sorry.
That's okay. Thank you, Madam Vice Chair, and thank you, Rep. Khan, for organizing this. My question is, I was struck by something that Mr. Anderson said when he was first testifying, and he said how the DSP, Mr. Butts, allows him to stay out of a nursing home, to live independently, to be a productive and contributing member of our communities. So I'm just wondering if we have any sense of, first of all, how many people are in a situation because there is, in a nursing home situation or something like that, because there is no DSP to provide support to them. And, you know, how much would we be saving if we were able to make sure that you know, people did not end up in that situation? I certainly think that being in a nursing home is far more costly. And if we took that expense and were able to shift that to providing more of a salary for the DSPs. And I have to just say, Mr. Butts, I really admire you and the work that you do. And I thank you very much for being here. You're very inspirational.
Thank you.
So I don't know, Mr. Janes, if you have a...
Yes, Representative. As of right now, there are over 12,000 Pennsylvanians on the waiting list for IDA supports. And there's also something that I would call a hidden waiting list. where people are eligible for supports but unable to find the requisite number of direct support professionals to provide those services. So that's something that that we don't necessarily count. But trust me, if you're a person with intellectual developmental disabilities waiting for those services, you're counting it. And you raise a good point. I also think that if we raise this wage, there are a number of people that are working full-time in my organization that qualify for additional benefits. The more we raise that wage, the less reliant those folks are going to be on those assistance plans, and the greater cost savings you're going to see overall at the state level. So it's a win-win. We are subject to one single payer, and that's our state and federal partner. I can't raise the wage or the cost of my sheets MTO to get somebody additional dollars. So really a great opportunity for us to create those savings by appealing directly to you.
Thank you very much. Representative Green.
Thank you. Thank you, RepCon, for convening this very important discussion. Thank you to the panelists. Thank you for the work that you do every day. I want to direct my question to you, Mr. Butts. How much do you currently make?
$12.50
an hour. And what would keep you on the job? What incentives, what benefits that you see that you are in the need of that would keep you on this job?
Yeah, I definitely would like an increase. I'm a graduate from Penn State, and I'm making way less than my colleagues are making. But I know this is an essential work field that needs people in the place. Some of the benefits that I would like to see is paid time off, retirement benefits, and what else? I guess that's all. But sick time off, like mm-hmm. just personal days off, like all above, like really, because it's definitely not just you just come to work and just it's really you're taking care of somebody. So it's
right.
Yeah.
I thank you for the work that you do every day. You are truly an inspiration, and I am 150% in agreement with you that you are underpaid and that you are not making a livable wage and that $12.50 is an insult, and $15 would be one as well.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rep. Green. And Rep. Borowski and I are basically saying, how dare you ask that? What do you think? This is a job? Yeah, this is your career. This is your job. You should have that. Representative Kazim.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Vice Chair. And thank you, Representative Khan, for facilitating this, and to all the panelists. And I just want to throw out there that when you think about years from now, and I'm sure most of my colleagues can agree, you don't really know where you'll end up. And I say that because now as a legislator, I actually started off as a DSP. So I have firsthand experience for years doing the job. And then now I'm also a mother of a young child who also requires care, where I have to rely on family a lot of times for that. So I just wanted to ask the question, but wanted to throw out there because I know we're talking a lot about the wages, but I really want a lot of my colleagues to understand, and I'm glad someone brought up about benefits, but one of the things that this can really help towards, as they stated, was more DSP workers because there is no backup. Currently, right now, I deal with a lot of back problems because of the fact that it was hard to take off because you know that most families didn't have a backup direct care support professional to be able to come in and support them. So you usually just never called out. Part of that is you don't get FMLA. So one of the things that I'm sure Representative Khan and Ronnie can also say, Representative Green, sorry, can also agree is that in healthcare, that is the majority career that I think it comes with like no type of support because it's really a 24/7 job. So the extra support that you need for your family is something you can't really give in. I also heard something about single moms. And that is majority of the DSP workers that do work, because I started off a single mom. So before I even had my son who needs care, I didn't have a child that needed care services. So now I'm on the end of knowing what it feels like to need that support. The 1250, I left when it was 1250, and that was about 8 years ago. I came in under $9. So all of that is to say that, do you agree that if we were able to raise the wages, we can be able to help facilitate with FMLA more often than rather a year later? Also, when it comes to workers' comp, that's something that I know a lot of DSP, where I heard you say a lot of times they start to get to your age because they stay in that because it's a career for them, but they have a lot of physical aftermath that comes from that and not being able to get the help. And then also, just even when it comes down to, I think Representative Borowski brought up about the nursing home and the difference in the pricing. But what I, one of the things I saw being on that side is a lot of times the nonprofits have went up also in wages when it came, in pricing on the care that they're giving, because they have to also provide a lot of like the Depends, and also the, it's been a long time, I'm trying to remember the name, the Chucks, thank you, the blue thing, the Chucks. So they have to provide the meals, you know, they have to provide, especially for people that don't have families, and also pay for like the mileage reimbursement. It's just so much they have to do from the home care perspective versus a nursing home who may have contracts with certain vendors. So with that, the health insurance companies may only be able to provide but so much money towards that, you like your organization. And what happens is the balance that is left, a lot of times family have to provide. And I'm adding that in is because I have two family members that I knew for years when I did that work who calls me to this day and ask, can I be able to come in and help them? Because they fell into that bracket where they weren't able to afford extra money to be able to pay for direct care support professionals. So I sometimes go in voluntarily to watch them where they either they take a vacation or they have to run to the market or whatever I have to do. But do you believe that with that, that would be able to help facilitate all of these different issues along with the reimbursement for the classes? Because I feel like the training classes are also not as available to be able to have qualified support professionals. So I just wanted to get your idea on that. Thank you for letting me run my mouth.
Thank you, Representative Kazima. Thank you for your service as a direct support professional. I'm very appreciative, and I'm glad that somebody understands the type of work and the difficulty of it. I can tell you that there are so many associated costs, and inflation has really done a number to our bottom line. You hit the nail on the head. There was a survey prior to the pandemic by our national association that it costs over $5,000 to replace a direct support professional in terms of training and all the other associated costs. So they snowball. Whenever you're sort of behind in the reimbursement rates, every little extra piece is more painful. So absolutely, when those rates go up, it makes it easier for us to afford certain things. We do a lot of sort of creative ways. We banded with a sister organization to create some shared purchasing, some economies of scale to try to drive those costs down. And, you know, as I told you before, nonprofit organizations are more innovative now than probably ever have been, because you're trying to make a dollar out of 15 cents, ostensibly. So absolutely. That reimbursement rate would be very increase would be very helpful across the board.
Thank you.
Thank you. One more comment.
Yeah, both Representative Kazim and Representative Borowski mentioned, I think it was you, maybe it was the person behind, well, anyway, it's two people mentioned the business of, the fact that this is actually cost beneficial. The entire community home-based waiver system is set up on the premise, and it's supposed to be based on proof that it actually saves money to have people living at home and be provided with care there than to go into nursing homes. And for people like Michael, you have to be nursing home eligible in order to be able to receive the services in the first place. So one strategy, of course, is always to say and ask the administration, hey, how about some numbers? Show us how it's working and how much money you're saving. And you can say, well, then we can certainly afford to pay more money. At the same time, recognizing that there's an another benefit other than simply saving money, which is it's a much better way to live, to be in a home, in your own home instead of in a nursing home. But anyway, that's one strategy.
Thank you. And our final question online.
Is that me, Jan? Is that me?
That's you.
Rep. All right. Thank you for recognizing me, and thank you guys for holding this hearing. I apologize. I was late to it. There was a transportation hearing at the same time. I just want to let folks know there is a task force that is looking at many of these issues called the HR 212 Task Force, which is looking at IDA services under the waiver system and how we are delivering them. And I think everybody has been calling out exactly the kind of things that we need to be paying attention to in that. And that is, we have to value the workers. We also have to value the people who receive services. And I think looking at them less as folks who are in need, and rather as folks who need to be able to get to a level where they can start to show us what they're all about and to contribute to society. I think a lot of times when we deal with the disability community, we devalue them and the contributions that they can make, and when we look at them only as people receiving services and not people giving things out. And I think I'm really glad to see both Josie and Michael on this panel as part of that conversation. They're definitely good examples of that. But I also think that when we are having these conversations, we've got to make sure we're placing proper value on everyone in the process, and making sure that every person who is within this system is being recognized for what they contribute to the society as a whole. So I will just say that, and then make a real quick request that any written materials that you've got, Rep. Khan, can you walk them down to my office at GO7 and drop them off there so that I can see anything that you guys have had today, so that know that I can start to put that to work in some of this task force that I'm on.
Thank you, Rep. Honstein. And I just wanted to uplift that the ask from the ARC and PAR, it was $430 million in the home and community-based waiver, an increase of $430 million. Representative Kazim just let me know that Kyren had said that, you know, you make $12.50 an hour. Other states are paying DSP, according to Rep. Kazim, $24. So, you know, there's definitely precedent for that. I just wanted to give Michael the final word to talk about Michael's Law. It was a co-sponsorship memo. That was just released. Michael, do you want to just talk for a minute to wrap up about Michael's Law?
Well, just sum it up. I could go on and on, but for years after college, I had a membership to all these local museums in Philadelphia. And one day, my mom said, "Where is you all my money going?" They said, "No, it's going." The attendance admission, because they were charging me twice. So I sued the Franklin Institute, and I won, and I was like on museums and all attractions. The state did not be able to charge DSPs because I can't afford to pay twice.
Thank you, Michael. And the bill's called Michael's Law, and it, like just as you said, it prohibits museums and other events from charging. As you mentioned, you know, you're making $12.50 an hour, you know, a person shouldn't have to pay for themselves and their DSP while they're working on the job to go to a museum. So.
And eventually I would like it to go all across the country, but statewide is a good start for me right now.
It is. I want to thank everyone for joining us today and to toss the final remarks to our chair, Bizarro.
Thank you, and thank you all for your very compelling testimony today. We greatly appreciate your input on this very important subject matter. And for final remarks, I'm going to hand it over to our host today, Rep. Kahn. Rep. Kahn, thanks again for calling this meeting to order.
Thank you, Chair. And I just want to thank my first, I want to thank my colleagues for being here. It means a lot to me that you came to support and learn about this important issue. Some of you have obviously a lot of experience with it and understand its importance. I also want to thank our chair, our vice chairs, Rep. Schusterman and Rep. Isaacson, and also our panel, GN James Michael Anderson, Karen and Dr. Karen Butts and Dr. Josie Badger. Thanks a lot. That concludes our meeting. We are adjourned.
Thank you.
Can I say that?
Well done. Well done.
Thank you.